Last time, we talked about the concept of superintelligence as proposed by philosopher Nick Bostrom at the University of Oxford. As mentioned in the previous video, he uses the term superintelligence to refer to intellects that greatly outperform the best current human minds across many very general cognitive domains. Now, this definition can be quite vague since many machines and animals already perform at superhuman levels in narrow domains. For example, calculators can easily outperform any human in arithmetic, while bats outshine us in interpreting sonar signals and so on. But although specialized information processing systems will continue to grow and expand, only with the prospect of machine intellects that have enough general intelligence to substitute for humans could have profound implications for humanity. So for Bostrom, it is important to separate the notion of superintelligence by distinguishing different bundles of intellectual supercapabilities. He decomposes the term superintelligence into three different forms: speed superintelligence, collective superintelligence, and quality superintelligence. Today, we will be taking a look at what Bostrom means by speed superintelligence and some of its defining characteristics. A speed superintelligence, according to Bostrom, is an intellect that is just like a human mind but faster. This is the easiest form of superintelligence to understand conceptually. So he formally defines speed superintelligence as a system that can do all that a human intellect can do, but much faster. Meaning, this system can be multiple orders of magnitude faster than the regular human mind. Now, the human brain's processing power is difficult to determine precisely, but common estimates range from 1014 instructions per second, or IPS, up to 1017 IPS or more. So speed superintelligence operating on a whole brain emulation, running on fast hardware, operating at a speed of 10,000 times that of a biological brain, would be far superior to any human that has ever lived. For example, it would be able to read an entire book in just a few seconds and write a Ph.D. thesis in an afternoon. Now imagine a speed of factor of a million. A brain emulation with that much processing speed could accomplish an entire millennium of intellectual work in just one working day. To such a fast mind, events in the external world would appear to unfold in slow motion. Now let's assume that your mind ran at a mere 10,000 times faster than a regular human. Then if your non-enhanced friend happens to drop her drink on the floor, you would watch the glass slowly descend towards the carpet over the course of several hours. This would give you enough time to not only order a replacement glass, but also read a few scientific papers and take a nap. This is very similar to how time slows down for some superhero characters, like the Flash from Justice League or Quicksilver from the X-Men franchise. But of course, in real life, a speed superintelligence would prefer to work with digital objects rather than physical ones due to this time dilation. It would prefer to live in virtual reality and deal in the information economy. Alternatively, it could interact with physical environment by means of nanoscale manipulators, since limbs at such small scales could operate faster than macroscopic appendages. So, enhanced people who like to be a part of the real physical world would still have a choice. But generally, a fast mind may want to interact mainly with other fast minds, rather than with extremely slow, sloth-like humans. Now, of course, the speed of light becomes an increasingly important constraint as minds get faster, since faster minds face greater opportunity costs in the use of their time for traveling or communicating over long distances. Light is roughly a million times faster than a jet plane, so it would take a digital agent with a mental speedup of 1 million times about the same amount of subjective time to travel across the globe as it takes a contemporary human traveler. Moreover, dialing somebody long distance would take equally as long as getting there in person, although it would be cheaper to call since a call would require less bandwidth. Agents with large mental speedups who want to communicate extensively might find it advantageous to move near one another. Extremely fast minds with the need for frequent interaction, such as members of a work team, may take up residence in computers located in the same building to avoid frustrating latencies. Now, all this may sound really impressive, but a superintelligence that is created by uploading a human intellect and then accelerating and enhancing it falls under what some call a weak form of superintelligence. This is because the outcome of this process produces a superintelligence that is a fundamentally upgraded version of one particular human mind. Other than that, it has no other special defining qualities. So many others, including Bostrom, have defined different, perhaps higher levels of superintelligences besides this one that are obtained through different means such as the AI route and so on. One of these includes collective superintelligence. So what differences does collective superintelligence possess when compared to speech superintelligence? Well, that is a discussion for another time. And that brings us to the end of this video. If you enjoyed it, do leave a like, share, and subscribe to our channel for more content ahead. What do you think collective superintelligence would be like once we attain it? Let us know your thoughts in the comment section down below. Until then, we'll see you in the next one.